the victory. We know there is more to come that we may not yet see. So with the faith you've given us, we'll step into the
yeah. Jesus, friend of sinners, we have strayed so far away. We cut down people in your name, but the sword was never ours to swing. Jesus, friend of sinners, the truth's become so hard to see. The world is on their way to you, but they're tripping over me. Always looking around but never looking up, I'm so double-minded. A blank-eyed saint with dirty hands and a heart divided. Sinners, break our hearts for what breaks yours.
To remember, we are all the least of these. Let the memory of your mercy bring your people to their knees.
Nobody knows what we're for, only what we're against when we judge the wounded. What if we put down our signs, crossed over the lines in love like you did? Open our eyes to the world at the end of our pointing fingers. Let our hearts be led by mercy. Help us reach with open hearts and open doors. Oh Jesus, friend of sinners, break our hearts for what breaks yours. Love every lost cause. You reach for the outcast, for the leper and the lame. There's a reason that you came. Lord, I was that lost cause, and I was the outcast. But you died for sinners just like me, a grateful leper at your feet.
'Cause you are good. You are good, and your love endures forever. You are good. You are good, and your love endures forever.
What's up, Heritage? What do you say, Heritage? How you doing today? Anybody happy in Jesus Christ? Would you say amen? Amen. We welcome all of you. We have special guests with us today. And if you are a visitor, make sure that you fill out a connection card or at least get your gift that we have for you out these back doors and to the left. You'll find a hospitality area, and we'll be able to answer some questions if you have some questions about us as a church. But one thing we like about a church is we like being a family. We also like being a church that reaches out to people outside of us and long, real far away. That's kind of what the church service is about today. But Scripture says this in Psalm 8. 18:3. I called on the Lord who is worthy of praise. Amen. Let's stand together. Do you think he's worthy of praise? We need to praise the Lord, praise God in his sanctuary, praise him in his mighty heavens. And the last one, let everything that breathes sing praises to the Lord. Make sure we do that. Somebody say amen. So Jesus be with us in our service. Calm our spirits, but lift our worship. Lord, help us to praise you well. But God, most of all, may the kingdom grow, the kingdom be made, Lord, as so much more real to all of us. And God, love these people, but God, help us to love you today. And Lord, we give you that honor today. In Jesus' name, amen. We're singing Chain Breaker. Is God big enough to break some chains? We better believe that, because we've got a ministry here that's all about that. And we're going to hear them in a second. But we're also going to talk about a God who's mighty to save. And then on top of that, we're going to end up with one of my all-time favorite songs, Revelation Song, where it's just worship together. What do you say? We just start right now with an amen on worship, and let's go.
You've been walking the same old road for miles and miles. You've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies. If you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life. There's a better life. You got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, chain breaker. We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run the things we know just ain't right. There's a better life. There's a better life. You got pain. He's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. You got chains. He's a chain breaker. Receive it. You can feel it. Somebody testify. Shake it, say no, you got chains. He's a
everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior.
In this song. Thank you. is. Let's pray. You are worthy, Lord our God, to receive honor in our praise. Lord, you created us, you've sustained us, you've saved us, Father, by sending your Son to die on a cross. And you rose on the third day to prove to us and to the entire world that you were exactly who you said you were. And because of that, Father, all we have to do is put our faith in you, and you will forgive us. You will cleanse us. You will place your Holy Spirit inside us, and you will empower us to live the life that you have called each and every one of us to live. And Lord, I pray that that same Spirit would fill this place here this morning. May everything that is said and done here this morning bring honor and glory to you, Jesus, for you are worthy. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Good morning, everyone. Just a reminder, the book of the month is Failing Forward by John Maxwell. You can find them at the Welcome Center on your way out if you like. Also at the Welcome Center are many, many giving statements still. So if you've yet to pick up your giving statements for last year, please do so at the Welcome Center. Also, today is hopefully the final fundraiser for the Papua New Guinea missions team that will be leaving in about a month. We are currently about 95% funded for the trip, which is a huge blessing. Yeah, you can clap if you want. It's all right. That's good. So we're hoping this fundraiser will put us over the top. So if you love Jesus, you will be sure to come over for some spaghetti. Amen. You'll find the details in your bulletin. I won't go through all those. You can read them yourself. But immediately after our service here, you can go over there and support a great work for the kingdom. Amen. All right. Also, just a reminder, this is Family Sunday. So if you don't have your kid with you, you should probably get them. I forgot mine this morning, and she just made her way in on her own. So I had to do some apologizing, but I still love you, Lily. But if our ushers will make their way forward and we prepare to receive tithes and offerings, as we're praying this morning and also throughout the week, I'd like to keep in our prayers the family of Shirley Wheatcraft. She passed away this week, and she's helped out in the nursery for several years, and we are so grateful for what God was able to do through her during her time that she had here with us. And just pray for the family, that they'll have strength and the peace in knowing that she is with Jesus. She has seen him face to face, and that should all give us hope. Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you once again for another opportunity to give towards your kingdom. Lord, we know we cannot outgive you. For those of us who have tried, Lord, it seems like the more we give, the more that you bless us with. And I pray that you would bless this offering, multiply it, and Lord, use it for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Just what he said.
I believe.
Oh, I won't have my mention there. Yes, indeed.
Not interrupt that song. I tried that once. We cut it off early the last one of these last times, and somebody let me know real fast, you son, you just hold on and let the Holy Spirit work just a few more moments. For I believe. Amen. Guys, we've been preaching a sermon series on follow the leader. The leader is Jesus Christ. Can I get an amen on that? And I'm going to talk to you a little bit. The first week was follow him to the river, where he baptized, being allowed to be baptized, he showed consecration, I'm all in. He then went to the wilderness, and we follow him to the wilderness and realize this, that he is in the dark places with us. And he understands how to overcome the devil. He knows how to overcome the enemy in all aspects. Our God is good enough to follow in and out of dark times. And the third, which was last week, was follow him to the certain place. Which means follow him to pray. Not the kind of prayer that, hey, I prayed today because between the house and the office, that was my prayer time. Not that that can't be used as prayer time. But I'm telling you what, how many distractions can you find in a car just between your house and you? You need to have a certain place, because Jesus had a certain place. Today is a very short sermon. Yeah! Today is a very short sermon because we have guests that we have, as a church, tried to bless them. And we are doing our best today to make sure that Bruce gets out of the way. And we allow them to get up, and we are going to show our appreciation. And at the same time, give them 10 or plus minutes to go ahead and share a little bit about their ministry. That obviously is not enough time, but so I've given them freedom to speak. But I want to talk to you today about following Jesus with your fishing pole. We are called. Hey, anybody ever heard this old joke where two guys are going fishing and they get in a boat and they go out in the middle of the lake and one guy drops his line in the water and he's waiting for his bobber to go under. Next thing he knows, this loud explosion. He turns around and his buddy, there's floating fish all around the boat. And he said, "What are you doing?" He said, "I'm fishing." He lit another stick of dynamite and dropped it in the water. Well, more fish come to the top. Till finally he said, "You can't do that. It's illegal." He lit another stick, threw it in his lap, and said, "You going to talk or you going to fish?" It's time the church stopped talking. It's time the church stopped talking and we start doing a whole lot of walking. And we are about Acts 1:8. Acts 1:8, you know, we shall receive power after the Holy Ghost comes upon us, and then we will become witnesses. Or if you allow me to insert God's context, and you will go into the world as fishermen. Because Mark 1:14, if you have your scripture, Mark 1:14 says this: "Now after John was put in prison, Jesus came to Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and saying, 'The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel.' And as he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew his brother casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. Then Jesus said to them, 'Follow me and I will make you become fishers of men.' They immediately left their nets and followed him." God, would you please bless this service? Lord, may what happens here send out your tentacles of love into the world. That, Lord, in Haiti and in Columbus, Lord, the ministries we have invested in, Lord, and these people we've invested in, God, may it be a powerful, powerful future as a partnership that we grow together. And that, Lord, we would see you do a great work. And thank you, God, for them. But God, make us fishermen. We all ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. And real quickly, the background to this is early on. Jesus is just now beginning his ministry. He's beginning to select his disciples. And by the way, he in the process finds fishermen at Galilee. Do you know that Josephus, the Jewish historian of that time, says that on the Sea of Galilee, by the way, I've been to the Sea of Galilee, it's not a big lake. And in fact, Lake Superior, Lake Erie, all those lakes are much bigger because no matter where Carmen and I went, we could always see the other side. It's a small lake, small sea. But Josephus said at the time of Christ, there were as many as 330 fishing boats on that lake. That's to me, to fathom 330 boats, that's crazy. They had to almost be knocking into each other.
But here we have that. Ordinary people, though, in Palestine were fishermen. By the way, Jesus loved working with ordinary people. The average guy. How many of you like the idea that you're an average guy with Jesus in your heart? That would put you in a great place. But fresh fish, my wife will tell you that fresh fish is the delicacy of the time. See, we like our cow, don't we? We like our pig. We like our cow. We like bacon. We actually had people come to us, and my daughter Faith, this is at a much younger age, she said, "We're bacon people." I like my meat. I like it red. I like it hot, and I like it juicy. And I'm sorry, I'm making this worse. But when we went to Israel, we found out that that is not the diet. And you guys are going to find this out real fast. It's not the diet. In fact, Carmen fell in love with it. I mean, she's going down this buffet, and there's raw fish, pickled fish, raw fish, pickled fish, raw fish. And I'm just looking at it, and I'm saying, give me the pickle. I don't want the fish. I love pickles. But that's what, but then they had for the tourists on the other end of the table, they had all of these red meats and you know, the typical, I'm talking breakfast now, they had like the stuff that they didn't like, but we did. And of course, most of the Americans were kind of over there. But they said, this is the Mediterranean diet. And my wife loved it. I mean, raw salmon and capers and, I mean, my son likes it too. But I got to tell you something, that was normal for them. And they like their fish. In fact, if you study it, you'll find out Rome, it was such a big deal for Rome that they named many of their cities around them fish names. Did you know what Bethsaida means? House of fish. So when we start talking about this whole concept of Jesus saying, I will make you fishers of men. On this particular day, Jesus walks by and he calls these fishermen. Now, I got to let you know something, and this won't take long, but this is not the first time that they've been with Jesus. And in fact, they have already heard him. They have already seen him. They've walked with him. Probably they were like the people that here. See, we have a core of people that they usually close the doors when they're here. They're the last ones to leave. And no doubt the disciples had reached a point where they were curious enough that they were the last ones to leave when it came to be with Jesus. And in this process, Jesus walking by and interrupts their workday, may I mind you. Hey, by the way, Jesus should be able to interrupt your workday.
Amen.
Okay? And so here's Jesus. Guys, come on, let me show you a different kind of fishing for men. The four words that I want to simply tell you that I think were amazing when I read them are these four words. I will make you. I will make you. So when he said, follow me. Guys, all I want to share with in just a few moments is simply this. When he said, follow me, because I will make you fishers. What he is saying is, don't stress over this. I'm going to make you. Amen. He's responsible. He will give the power. So now I'm not saying you shouldn't read books on how to reach lost people. I'm not saying you shouldn't get your evangelism missionary books out and read about how you can really get a Willow Creek book out and learn how to go to the other side of the room. I mean, there's a lot of different things you can do. I'm saying you can still do that. But know this, the bottom line is Jesus is taking the responsibility of making you a disciple. That means it's on his shoulders. All I got to do is follow. That's easier said than done. Because following, my friends, is an all-in. Following is completely committed. Following him means that you have said no to everything else as being God. And yes to him. But I'm telling you, loving Christ will automatically make you a fisherman. Amen? Loving Christ. By the way, two people got saved in jail ministry this week, and two people got saved at Rose Avenue last night. So praise God for that. So we're already fishing. But what did Jesus mean by he would make them fishermen? Number one, he would show them how to fish. By showing concern for Peter's mother-in-law, he was showing concern. Guys, you can fish for people by showing concern. Right? Thank you very much for the four people that just said amen. By showing compassion on the hungry crowd. Remember when the crowd, and he said this, you know, we can't let these people leave hungry. He was concerned for them. He showed compassion on them, and by blessing the little children, he said, don't forbid the kids to come to me. Those kids matter. Amen. You see what I'm saying? Learning how to fish from Christ, he, by merely following his story and following what he has done, he shows us how to treat people, how to love people, how to show mankind that there is a God. Amen. Because we know him personally. And by the way, I'll make this fast. You have to love the fish before you catch the fish. I take you back to Israel. I hated that breakfast. And now, granted, you didn't have to eat it, right, Bruce? You didn't have to eat it? No, but my wife did. So I'm sitting across the table, smelling that stuff. To be honest with you, they weren't going to convert me, no matter how hard they tried. And my wife wasn't going to convert. She's still eating salmon and capers once in a while. No. So becoming a Mediterranean person is probably not going to be at the top of my love list. But lost people have got, they've got to be at the top of the love list. It was for Christ, and it should be for us. We should care about people in Haiti. We should care about people where everybody else has given up, but there are a handful of people that haven't, and they love them. And that's the stuff that we're talking about. And he would prepare them to fish. Others would be fishing. Or, you know, do you remember when the disciples said, hey, those guys over there are casting out demons in your name, Jesus. Tell them to stop. What was his response? No! Leave them alone. They're not doing it like you, but they're doing it for me. Amen. Guys, a part of learning how and being prepared to fish is to understand this. Your job is not to be a critic of all the other people. I remind you of D.L. Moody, who D.L. Moody said, a lady walked up to him and said, I don't like the way you evangelize. And he says, how do you do it? She said, I don't. He says, I like my way better. Our job is to be faithful to God. Our job is to care about lost people. Our job is to fish for men and women and children. And we prepare that. You know, Jesus would remind them that whoever seeks to be first and the greatest must be last and like and be a servant. I tell you a story, interesting story from Norway. Two guys were fishing in a river that had been known once in a while the current would grab a hold of them. And this particular fisherman who had been fishing for 25 years was watching a guy and his waders on the other side. The current caught him, ripped him into the river, and he started going quickly to what would ultimately have been his death. The 25-year fisherman, realizing he knew the river well, so he got out of the water, ran in his waders as hard as he could run to the next bridge. And what he did was he had one chance. And his one chance was he was going to catch this man in the middle of the river with a hook. He had one chance. But because he had 25 years experience, he caught the man. Now, here's the hard part. How many of you ever fish in a river with 250-pound line? You see, he said the hard part wasn't necessarily getting him. The hard part was keeping him. And he said it took every technique that he had learned in 25 years to get that man out of the water. But when he got him out of the water, he thought to himself, thank God for the men who taught me how to fish. Thank God for the men who gave me the skills and the tackle box and all the right things so that I could be where I was at that time. Fishermen understand this. Fishermen of God know this. Divine appointments are coming. And we need to be prepared. Don't make lightly your Sunday school education. Don't make lightly the small group gatherings that you have. May the Word come alive. May the Word all of a sudden give you a tackle box that's able to save even the hardest of situations. So He prepares us and He shows us how to fish. Next, He also equips them to fish. In the midnight, He would teach them wisdom. In miracles, He would help them to understand. With the rejections that He had, He would equip them with love. Being equipped means being content with your tackle box and bait. Last, I've already said it, He would create the opportunities to fish. He sent them out by two so that they would learn. Even when the demon-possessed boy couldn't be delivered by the disciples, He still taught them how to get out of that failure mentality and to learn how to do it right. Jesus would bring the fish to us in every day of life. That's what we have to understand. I close with this story, then we'll get right into the good stuff. One of the most moving stories I ever heard in college was a story of a man by the name of Charlie Peace. On July 4th, 1864, he was headed to the gallows to be hung for his crimes. As was tradition, Anglican preachers would walk in front of the criminals on their way to the gallows, and he would read from his book of prayer. And what he was reading was scriptures on hell. And as he is getting closer and closer, this is absolutely, I better get up here to make sure I say it exactly how he said it. But after he had read all of this nasty stuff, Charlie Peace stopped him and he shouted and he said, "Do you believe what you have just read?" And the Anglican priest said, "I suppose so." He said, "I don't." And here's why. He said, "If what you just read is true, and that is a miserable reality for someone, I would crawl across all Great Britain on my hands and knees on broken glass to save just one person."
Amen.
Church, God wants us to be fishers of men. I have one question for you. Do you believe it? Do you know there's a hell? Do you know there is what we know to be afterlife that is not good? There's two destinies. Do you believe that? Then here's one good thing to say, and I just kind of made it negative. The good thing is this: God has made us the people that can make the difference. The church is still the answer to the world because they have Christ. And my friends, we are so blessed today. Amen. As people to be going to the jails and to be going to the prisons and to be going, ladies and gentlemen, to Rose Avenue for our community center over there to last year, what is it, 42,000 touches last year. Praise God for that. And our Sunday school classes and our children's ministry and our student ministry, all those things are touches because we are trying to reach and keep people for Christ. But we are Acts 1:8. We will always be a people of Acts 1:8. Jerusalem. You see, last year the Jesus birthday offering was for Jerusalem. We raised funds for our food pantry. And also for Jody's kids ministry. And we were blown away by your generosity. But it showed us one thing, that you guys care about being fishermen. So then we decided to go to the uttermost part. I know I'm not sequentially correct. But we went to the uttermost parts of the world. And we went to Judea, Samaria. This year. Last year, almost $15,000. I don't know, Lisa, was it close to that, $15,000? Well, she's saying it was more than that last year. This year, you have contributed over $24,000. Amen. For ministry. And my job, and I've gone way too long, but you guys don't worry about it. All I'm saying is we are right now going to present to these individuals the check. Okay? And then, of course, they'll get the real one later. But we're going to go ahead and take a picture. The first group that we've got here is the church on Como. This is Tim and Beth Tabor. I want them to come up right now, if you guys would, please. And we so appreciate these guys. Amen. Their ministry. They're going to share with us here in the next few moments. But guys, I want you to let them know how much you appreciate the ministry. Tell me right. Hold on a minute. Okay. Would you let them know how much you appreciate their ministry? Come on. Amen. I'll take this guy. So sorry. Okay. By the way, the other day, some people said at Winter Jam that they even brought you up at Winter Jam. So this is a ministry that's been recognized by more than just our church. So praise God for that.
Well, good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for and thank you so much for your generosity. I'm going to share a little bit about how we got to where we are, and then Beth's going to tell you a little bit about what our program is.
I just took their picture.
Oh, you just took their picture? Okay. Did you guys smile? You want to do it again? Everybody smile this time?
Everybody smile.
Okay, everybody smiles. Wave high. Okay, there we go. My name's Tim. This is my wife, Beth. And in 2000, and I'm going to give you a quick kind of run of how things came together for us. But in 2008, we decided we wanted our kids to really understand before they got out of high school what it meant to follow the will of God, and we started a Bible study with them. And we actually gave them these Bible study books for Christmas. And we did this 13-week Bible study with our kids, which they rejoiced about. But out of the Bible study after a little while, we said, well, do you want to invite your friends? And they said, yeah. And we said, well, if you're going to invite your friends over, it's going to be on a Sunday night, and there's going to you got to clean your room, and you got to do certain things. And so we started a Bible study in our home in 2009, and it became a thing called home church. Their friends started coming to our house. Now, we live in a neighborhood in the city. We don't live too far from Easton. And so on Sunday nights, we would get home. We'd come home after church. There'd be people kind of already there. But about 6 o'clock, young adults and teenagers would come into our house, and we would just have a quick Bible study. And as we begin to do that, now there'll be 30 to 40 of those people coming to our court, so our neighbors loved us too, every Sunday night. And they started showing up with tattoos and gauges and piercings and things like that, which the people, your neighbors, really love. And we noticed that they wouldn't go to church anywhere. We tried to get them to go to the church we were attending, which is my brother's church, and they wouldn't do that. And so God allowed us in 2010 to open a church in Worthington at Beth's dad's place. And it was, we called it the Church at 85 because I'm not real good with names, and that was the address. You'll catch more of that later. But so we started a church because we couldn't get people who didn't go to church to go to church. And then we still kind of couldn't get them to go to church. But we opened the church then and started and still had home church and started working with. Well, as we was going through home church one night, a couple of our home church leaders show up with this guy. And this guy is so high, he barely knows his name. And they said, can he spend the night here? And I'm like, no. And Beth said, yes. So he spent 9 months with us. Because that's what happens when you're, somebody has someone over. But we begin to then take in more people. We found out there was a need, that there was addiction, but it was deeper than we even understood. It was opiate addiction, heroin, most of you guys know, and that there was a need to help people here. And so, church leaders. Now, these guys aren't church people, and most of them didn't have a church background. They said, we can't live out our faith in our homes. Will you guys rent us a house? And I said, again, no. And so we rented them a house. Because Beth had been praying about it, and we opened our first men's ministry house, and so we began taking the girls into our house and having a safe place for the guys in another house that we rented. And that was in 2011. And in 2012, we noticed that we needed to do more than what we were doing for the people who were addicted. So Beth started a program, and she kind of said, well, can we help people and they can still have their jobs and do this? And we started taking more people in who had problems with addiction. And finally, one night, she wakes up and says, we need to get another house. And by this time, I'm starting to get it. And I said, oh, okay, where do we get the house? She said, I know we can rent a house. And so we rented a house, and we started officially our recovery program, which is a full-time faith-based called Therapeutic Community. Beth's going to explain a little bit more to you about that in a minute. And we opened our first recovery house, and we kept taking the girls into our house, and we had two men's houses. And this is in 2013. At that time, we knew we was going to lose our building, and we started looking for another place to go. And my mother-in-law said, hey, there's this church that's really dilapidated in the middle of town. Are you interested in it? And Beth and I said, well, we'll go look at it. And then we're sitting there one day, and it's an old Methodist church, old white church, and I'm sitting there in a March day, and it's snowing in on me through the window. And Beth goes, what do you think? I said, I don't know. She said, can we afford anything else? I'm like, no. So we bought this church. You know, it was just totally, you know, 100-year-old church was just totally dilapidated. And we started the program in 2013. And as we kept going on, we found out the people in the program needed not only instruction, but they needed some skills. And so Beth's really good at skills. We got kind of an odd family dynamic. She does drywall and paint and plumbing and electric, and I cook and do laundry. Just the truth. I'm sorry about it, but that's the truth. And so we started in 2014. We started kind of a company to go along with it, and in just the last year, because I want to kind of turn this over to Beth, we bought our fifth house this summer with an outrageous movement of God. We had to raise $30,000 to get it, and we don't kind of operate on those kind of numbers. And God just came through in miraculous ways to do it. And also at this time, God kind of directed us to help oversee inner city ministries in Columbus, which is kind of a whole other story. What God is really kind of moving in us is how we are helping opiate addicts kind of become new people. And I'm going to let Beth tell you a little bit more about Como Recovery. Just put the slide of the guy up.
The beginning one.
Yeah. Yeah, that one. She's going to tell you about Corey.
Hi. this is Corey. And I'm sure you all would like to live with him, wouldn't you? That's Corey. 18 months ago, I interviewed Corey in Richland County Jail. About almost 18 months. Well, actually 18 months ago, Wednesday. And February 9th, Corey is going to finish our program, so he's going to graduate. And I know, isn't that awesome? So Corey is an IV, Corey was an IV heroin user, and he came, like I said, he came to us 18 months ago. So here's what our program is. Our program is a long-term faith-based residential recovery program. Long-term, obviously, the average time that people come and stay with us is 18 months. Up to the longest we've had somebody is, how long was that? Almost 3 years, right?
Yeah.
And she's actually came from Washington Courthouse. So the minimum time somebody comes and stays with us is 18 months, and the maximum time is right now at like 20, or almost 3 years. And so what happens when somebody comes to us, what happened when Corey came to us, he surrendered, well, he didn't have a job, so he didn't have to give that up. But you give up your phone, your car, your job, all internet access, caffeine, and you live with us, and you live with us until you're well. And so what happens is for the first 40 days, you have no contact with anybody in the outside world at all. And then after 40 days, you get, the only thing that changes in your life is you get one visit on a Sunday from noon to 3:30, and then one 10-minute phone call. So it's kind of a little bit like jail, but not really. We're nicer. And maybe the bed is softer. I don't know. They might not agree with you. Agree with me on that. And so then after that, they spend the next year learning a whole bunch of skills. By the time they graduate, they have 51 recordable and trackable skills. And I don't mean like how to paint or whatever. It's how to live life on life's terms. They learn how to deal with their anger, deal with their emotions. They learn how to think. You would be surprised how much people actually don't think. They just kind of emote everywhere. So we teach them to have their thoughts engage their emotions, not their emotions engage their thoughts. Heroin is usually the end, it's not the beginning. And so they have a whole lot of really poor behavior, and they have to learn how not to engage in their behaviors and engage in their defects. So if you start our program and finish our program, so here's what Corey's life has looked like for the past 18 months. He's attended no less than 207 AA meetings. He has spent 692 hours in group with me. We're kind of buddies, sort of. And so what that actually means is if you would start our program and only go to our program once a week, it would take you 13 and a half years to finish. So Corey will finish with about 13 and a half years of intensive counseling. So he better be well. If not, I'm going to follow him around. Right around 12 months, they enter intermediate. And this is our best shot at incorporating people back into the real world. So at right around 12 to 13 months, they get to either get a job or go to school. Our girl that's graduating with Corey is in school right now, and she's actually on the dean's list at Columbus State. Isn't that amazing? So they can work 20 hours a week, and then they still have to attend group and do all of their stuff, work at the inner city or whatever that they have to do. And then someplace along that time, they do Boundaries, which is a Christian, a faith-based book teaching you boundaries. And if you've never done it, it's really, really a good, it's good for anyone. So they do the Boundaries book. They go to Financial Peace University because we want to teach them to be givers and not takers. And Corey actually gave his very first paycheck to the church to help open our fifth house. So is that's quite a transformation. They finish the first seven steps of AA. So they go to Financial Peace, AA, and all of that group. And then when we actually decide that they are fully new, because we believe that God can and will make them completely new, they get to graduate. So like I said, February 9th at 7 p.m., Corey has... I have a blog, and if you want to follow their lives, you can read the blog. His blog name is Mr. Grumpy. So Kristen and she's Wheezy. So Kristen and Mr. Grumpy are graduating. If you put his after picture up, that's Corey today. And like I said, when he came to us, he came from Richland County Jail. And the before picture is exactly what he looked like when I went into the little cell and interviewed him. His mom didn't want him. Nobody wanted him. His probation officer had pretty much decided that is it. He had robbed his family, almost blind. And, his mom now has her son back. That's amazing to me. We just are there to let God use us. You know, for us, it's the most incredible journey to watch somebody go from before to the after. And so there's not anything more that we'd rather do. It's just to watch God actually transform somebody to be brand new. And now you all participate in it. So that's pretty awesome. So.
Amen. What a great work they're doing. Thank the Lord. And you are, as she said, I liked how she said it, we now are part of that. We've joined them. And we have another ministry we're going to bring up, Jacob and Chelsea, right now. And they came to us one night when the weather wasn't real good and our crowd was down. But they too stole our hearts. And they are the ministry of Living Waters for Haiti. And let's go ahead and give them a round of applause. Let them know how much you appreciate them. I'll take this down. You go ahead.
Well, Jake and I usually do a tag team deal, so you'll get both of us. And we heard the news of what your church had given, and a good thing we were sitting down because it blew us away. We were here on a really cold Wednesday night, and there was only a few of you. And we were late because of the weather, and Jake got off work late. And so we thought, oh, well, maybe it'll touch someone and they'll feel compassion and they'll help our cause. And if not, at least we're doing what God asked. So to get the news that you guys were so giving, we just can't be more thankful. And we're thrilled to be here to tell you what we're going to do in partnership with you with the money. So do you want to start with the story? So in case we can recap.
Where we started?
Yeah.
Sure. And just to recap for those of you who weren't here, Chelsea and I started going to Haiti in 2003, drilling water wells. And actually, I was a water well driller by trade, so we were constantly sought after by different groups. They knew that we were in different churches, and we were sought after by different groups to go and drill water wells, because water is such a huge need. And what's so exciting to us is it's easy for churches or people to get on board with, say, orphans or different groups, or they decide, hey, we're going to give a little bit of money and then we did our part. But to see the passion you guys have for clean water is just amazing to us, because once you go to some of these different countries and see the need for the clean water, it will just break your heart when you see children from, you know, 4 years old all the way up through adults carrying water 3, 4, 5 miles one way, and that's their job to do every day. They don't go to school, they don't have friends. What they do is they carry water buckets all day long. So it just touched our hearts when we started going, and we thought, okay, we've got to do more. This is my trade. We have to try to do something more. So from that point, we've moved forward, and it's always a struggle in these different countries, whether it's funding or equipment or just the different
darkness
that we're battling when we go there. So from that point, we've moved forward. We've drilled with the different organizations almost 40 wells with one organization, and probably 12 with another organization. So with that, we've moved into, when we were going to these communities, we're drilling, our equipment is older equipment, so we're there, we're spending a long period of time. Like the last well we drilled, I think took 36 days. We just have old equipment like my grandfather used, and so we were in these communities for this long period of time. We started building these relationships, and we started seeing the difference that we made in their lives. In that, we also realized some of the needs that were there, some of the medical needs, some of the housing needs, and we thought, hey, if we're here drilling, you know, I don't know how to build a house, but I'm sure we can figure it out. This family of 11 doesn't have a place to live. So let's start building a house here. So that's where we've kind of grown with our ministry.
So Jake's a water well driller by trade. His family has a well drilling company in our area here since 1946. So there's a difference when you drill a water well in the state of Ohio, and people kind of expect water. You know, we always have it. We don't think about how valuable it truly is. And you can go anywhere in your home and open up your, you know, your spigot or turn on your faucet, and out comes water. I don't know if you really know the value till you go and you see people who are literally walking for miles. Back in 2004 was around the first water well, 2003, 2004, and we went into a little village in Haiti, which is only a 2-hour flight from Miami, Florida. It's not that far away. And we went into a little village where there was hundreds of people, women, children, husbands, and they had no water. And when we started to ask how far they were walking, and we actually drove the trip, it was 13 miles. A whole community walking 13 miles. So they didn't have jobs. The children weren't in school. All they did all day long was just to go fetch water, because they needed it for things that we need it for. They wash, they cook, and now the problem is also those water sources where they're getting their water, whether it's rivers or natural springs, they're also contaminated, because somebody higher up on the mountain maybe has an animal that died, or an animal that was drinking out of the water, or maybe that was a site for a burial. And so the contaminated water comes down the river, and then people are drinking it, and cholera, dysentery, there's a lot of illness that comes from drinking unclean water. What we're offering now is to go into a village with your help, and this will be a partnership, because just collecting the money was literally the first step. It's a big step, and we're so happy. But now you guys need to come with us. You need to partner with us to find your location. Where do you want to go? And what village do you want to choose where they need water? And we're going to drill a water well. What that looks like is we come into that area, and Jake's a driller, and he hires a local Haitian staff so that we're helping the community, giving people some work. And I go around and play with children and find babies. Just kidding. I do other things that hopefully you girls can come with me. And we work with orphans. We feed people. We have medical clinics. We have VBS. We do all that kind of stuff while Jake's doing the hard work. And when you go into the village, people dance and they sing and they cry and they praise God and they fall to their knees. And I don't think we've ever had that with a water well in Ohio, right, Jake?
Not yet. We're still waiting on that.
Unless they might cry when they find your price out or something, right? Yeah, they're not cheap. But at any rate, so they dance and they sing and they don't say thank you, Jacob and Chelsea and, you know, Heritage. They say, thank you, God, you sent these people. And I'm telling you, we step out of the way because they go to their church and their arms are all raised and they're singing and praying. And it's like we're invisible. They think he just brought us to get this job done. So in that, you're there several weeks and Jake's drilling and you start to build relationships. And every day, Jake would say to a little girl, what's her little name, the little one you love?
Senorita.
He would say to her, Senorita, Jesus loves you. And he'd say it in Creole, because his Creole is pretty good. And she would say, I know. And he would say, you know, every day. Then he'd come back, you know, Senorita, Jesus loves you. And she needed to go to school. So guess what? We came up with $120, walked to her school with her one day and paid for her little school. On her first day of school, we brought her a Barbie doll so we could celebrate her school. Every day, Jesus loves you. And one day he said, Senorita, do you know who Jesus is? And she said, some white guy? She didn't know. So all this time we'd been there thinking we're doing this mission, we're doing this great work in God's name, and they don't even know who Jesus is. And part of that is because they don't own a Bible. They're too poor. I mean, people make less than a dollar a day. They don't have money for a Bible. And honestly, I couldn't even find a Bible. It's very difficult to even find a Creole Bible. So we do bring Bibles. We try and help them. And then if they have a Bible, they can't read. It needs to be interpreted. Only 54% of the population can read. And in America, it's 99%. So they can't read even if they have one. So we have a responsibility to go and help. And clean water is our way. It's our way. We go. They listen. And once you provide that, then the whole world opens up. And in just response, Jake will probably want to talk because I'll take over, but they talk about fishers of men, and I've heard that, and I just love it because we are not educated people. He's a well driller, and I think fishermen are up here. You know, you have maybe a doctor and a lawyer, and then there's a fisherman, and then well drillers, right, Jake? Like, you're way underneath. Seriously, that's their reputation. So I feel they're hard guys. They're rough guys. You go to the job site and you have to close your ears because it's terrible there. And yet, God still said, you have to go. You know, I don't have any kind of degree. I came from parents that were just good people, but I wasn't in the church. And when I was a younger lady, he said, go ahead and go. And I just wanted adventure. And now look, so I'm saying no one is excluded. You don't have to have any kind of special degree. You don't have to be a pastor of your church. Like, you just have to love Jesus and you can go. I mean, at one point I'm thinking about being fishers, but honestly, I think we were the fish. Like, we needed fish, right? We needed somebody to fish us. So it's our turn now to go. And honestly, I could stand here and tell you, orphans, oh, you guys probably would have given money to orphans, right? Orphans are sad and pathetic and they need us. Water, not many people connect with water, and I'm blown away that you guys do, and you recognize the importance. So we have some really great news, too, on that front. Just this week, we found out about the money that your church had raised, and we are so excited. Do you want to tell them about the good news?
Go ahead. You're on a roll now, girl. You might as well keep right on going.
Just go.
Sorry. No, that's all right. And she's right, honestly, about being fished. I know we come to some groups and they're sitting there and they think, okay, here's these people that have been perfect their whole life. They've been in church. They follow Jesus. They do everything right and they're perfect. And I have to tell you that that's not the case. I'll just keep it real quick as it's Children's Day here today, but I was not that person. As a young man, I was not a good man. At 16, I had a child, went through some really difficult times with, whether it was alcohol or drugs or whatever stage of my life that I was in. There was a time in my life where the best thing I could do was if I got to a bar. By the end of the night, if I had a good fight and a few other things happened, that was a good night. And I really was down until I had someone that fished me. So anyone sitting out there, you guys, Jesus is calling every single one of you, no matter what you've done, no matter where you've been. And God is waiting for us to go and preach his word. And that being said,
week. Yeah. That was last week. This is a whole new week.
But anyways, we get this call and we've been struggling. We've been struggling with the rig. Our rig has been breaking down. We've been at the UN. We've been trying to find equipment. The rig we were using, the motor blew up. We're trying to find, the money to get it, which is going to be $8,000 or $10,000, which is difficult for us. So we get this news from you guys, and this is amazing. So I'm like, all right, I got to hurry and find this motor, and I got to find the funding for it. So I'm driving down the road, and my phone rings, and there's a gentleman Wednesday. There's a gentleman down there who has been drilling for years, and he's a little bit away from where we've been drilling. And they have this really nice, it's a cable rig, so it's still older, and it's still the slow style, but it's really nice. And we've always been really envious of this rig. It's like, I want that guy's rig, because it's got a diesel motor on it, and it's really nice.
Yeah, so I'm not envious. The rig's yeah. Excitement.
But he calls and he says, "Hey, Jake, this is Lloyd." And I'm like, "Hey, how's it going? How's everything going?" He goes, "Just great." But he's an older gentleman. He's about 72 now, I think. He says, "We've outlived, our ability to go down there, and I'm getting ready to retire. And I just want to give you my rig." And I'm like, "Oh, I had to pull off the side of the road, and it's like." So God is awesome and works in such awesome ways, but we want you guys to be a part of picking our locations, picking these villages. We want, we would love for you to come and see where we're going. So our next step is we'll go down, we'll start talk with our different resources we have in the area, and we want to find the area that makes the biggest impact for each well. The last well that we drilled was so overwhelming we didn't realize the impact that we were having, because we see the 20 or 30 people that we're working with and that are right there living close to you as you're working. So you think, okay, we're affecting 30 or 40 people who are walking a long ways. Well, once we got the water flowing and got the water pumping, Chelsea and I decided one night, okay, we just got it started. We'll pump it here until everybody gets their buckets full, and then we'll go back to where we're staying. But we started pumping water. Well, the news got out that there was water. So we stayed for 3 hours until it got dark, and there was a constant flow of children and people and adults, praising Jesus or praising God, and they're bringing their buckets up. We stayed for 3 hours. It got dark to a point to where we had to go for different safety reasons, and there was still a line of maybe 150 people with 50 buckets lined up back there. So we don't realize the impact we have that we go, and we want you guys to be a part of that in choosing that spot. So one well, two, maybe three wells that we're going to be able to do with this could affect thousands and thousands of people.
Yeah. So. Okay, I have one last thing, and then I'll let you go. The cool part about drilling a water well instead of just using their sources already is that it's a closed off source, so we can chlorinate it and we can keep the contamination down, so there's no disease. The wells that have been drilled already, even through the hurricane that just swept through that area that I was in and we go to, the wells that were closed that have been drilled stayed, have kept the communities safe, so they're not dying of diseases like cholera. So it's very important to have this. So we keep a maintenance program. We use the local community and the local workers to do that. And then lastly, I can't leave without telling you guys that we come up here and we talk to you about it being, you know, kind of our mission and what we've done. But we actually are a little piece of this. We are merely messengers to get through to you that God has sent to tell you that we're speaking on behalf of all the people who we see who literally don't have a voice. And I know there's been a lot of fighting within our country lately, but I have to say, this is a fight we need to fight. This is a worthy fight. You know, I can tell you, I'm standing here right now, and not as Chelsea, but I'm representing a little gal named Stephanie. Stephanie is an orphan in one of the orphanages. You guys can meet her if anybody comes with me. Stephanie was given away by her family when she was little because there's too many mouths to feed. So unfortunately, kids have to be given away. She ended up with a man who was on a boat who kept her as a sex slave when she was 8. She was on that boat until she was 13, and she was rescued and sent to a little orphanage. And then as the 13-year-old in the orphanage, she got pregnant. And now Stephanie has a little girl named Marianne, who we love dearly. But I'm up here speaking for Stephanie because she needs somebody to fight for her. Stephanie doesn't have a future if it's not for us. And I'm fighting for Zizi, who's a fisherman whose boat was just destroyed, and now his only form of raising money for his family is gone because of the hurricane. And Zizi is thin. His bones stick out of his chest and they stick out of his back. His arm has been broken and isn't healed properly. And he's old and he carries a machete to do some work like most Haitian men do, and he loves his family, but he has no voice, and so we need to come to tell you that it's for him. And lastly, it's for a little boy named Gene, who you can meet as well. And Gene's a restivic, and Gene is a restivic in Haiti is exclusive. It's a child slave. That's a form that's still legal in the country. 300,000 children slaves in Haiti, and they're used in the worst ways. They're used as not only for sex, but they're used in ways they just work them to the bone. And all Gene wants is just to be loved. So as Jake and I stand here, please remember that we're merely messengers, and that we're coming for all these people who literally need a voice. Thank you so much. We can't wait for this partnership. You're absolutely amazing.
You guys are amazing. Thank you so much.
Amen. That's right. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Amen. I love partnerships, don't you? You may be seated. I just want to ask them a couple questions. The night they were here, they were allowed to show a lot of pictures. What they have shared today has already given us tears and concern, and what Tim and Beth are doing, man, praise God for that. But I think you said something, Jacob, when you're here, over 90% of the problems in Haiti could be solved by clean water. Did you hear that? That country the size of Vermont. I remember this stuff because it's a country the size of Vermont, and how many hundreds of thousands of people that are homeless?
There's 800,000 starving people. Homelessness isn't even recognized because there's so many homeless. I mean, what do you call it? What do you call a tent or a tarp? It's not really a home.
It's not really a number that's been given. At this current point, there's about 800,000. I know that was pre-hurricane figures.
Yeah.
So there's somewhere around 800,000.
Yeah.
And starvation. I can say, like, you don't know what it's like till you see a mother in line fighting for rice for her children. Like, we fight for iPods at Walmart during Christmas. I mean, there's nothing to describe that feeling. Honestly, when a piece of rice is dropped, a mother will bend down and pick it up in her skirt and take it with her. So there is nothing that you can even compare to starvation, and we don't even understand that. So, and to feed children, I mean, it sounds so cliche to stand up here and say, oh, we feed the hungry children. But literally, listening to starving children chewing, it's incredible. It's a feeling you'll never, a sound you'll never forget.
Yeah. Amen. Guys, love you so much. Thank you. God bless you. And also, don't forget this, that and I'm sure Tim and Beth would even say the ministry is more important. Getting it done is more important than the actual money that's been received. But these guys do this. Every dollar goes straight to Haiti. So they've been going for years on their own dime for this. So guys, God bless you again. Hey, Tim and Beth, you'd stand if you guys would stand. And just one more time, let these guys know how much they are loved and appreciated. Praise God. Yeah. Guys, I'm gonna go ahead and send the crab trees and the tabers into the foyer. Guys, if you would, please, and that'll give you a chance to get to know them. I believe Brad Harmon's on his way right now to play the song that he played last week. We're going to close the service with this song, I Have Decided to Follow Jesus. Is that a good song for us to end up this series? Yes, absolutely. I Have Decided. So as he's getting his stuff together, right now, before we sing, turn to your neighbor and just say, today's been a great day, and God's going to use us in big ways. Amen. Every dollar, guys, this is good news. Every dollar provided through your offering will save a life. Did you hear that? Will save a life. Amen. Every dollar. Praise God for that. So Brad, you lead us if you would, please. And let's all sing with him, and then we'll have our final prayer. To be the lighthouse where they are. God, we can't wait to see your face. But use us until that day in Christ's name. Amen. God bless you.